Hello, can you hear me? Can anybody hear me? You hear me? Okay. We're all good. All right, so do I just start here or what?
Yeah, we'll go ahead and debate, but I want to let you know how much time you have and how much time I have and all that, so you got it down. You can try to keep it like under 20 minutes, night hippie chick. Try to keep it under 20 minutes, and then I'll try to keep mine down under 20 minutes. And we might as well talk about what we're going to debate. Let's debate. What makes more sense, atheism or Christianity? Or do you want to debate on, how about this? How about does God exist? Do you want to do that instead? Religion? Did you want to do does God ex-? Okay, so you're okay with it? Okay. So we can do does God exist? And you could take up to 20 minutes, and then I'll also take 20 minutes. We could take up to 20 minutes, and then I'll also take 20 minutes. And now, religion is a joke. Do you mind if I use the slides, the PowerPoint slides? I know you don't have any slides, but do you mind if I do that? I won't do it if you don't mind, because it makes it more interesting for the people here. But if you don't want me to, I won't. But I got like a little PowerPoint. All right, thanks. Religion is a joke. Do you mind if I just begin and fly through it real quick? And have you ever seen it, religion? Have you ever seen the presentation? All right, so we'll go through it. Okay, let me get my clock ready, okay? You ready? Now, I'm debating religion. Oh, by the way, religion, are you an atheist? You're an atheist, right? You said you're an atheist? Okay. So let's take 20 minutes, okay? I'll take 20 minutes or less. I'm going to start now. Now, we're debating. Does God exist? And religion's going to give reasons why he believes God doesn't exist. So rather than me attack straw men at this point, I'll just wait for him to answer this question. What good evidence does he have that God does not exist? Now, I must warn you guys, atheists have tried for centuries to disprove the existence of God. They still haven't been able to. So let's go through some of these arguments. The universe's existence, we'll start there. You guys know the cosmological argument. Whatever begins to exist has a cause. The universe began to exist, therefore it follows logically that the universe has a cause. Now, this is not just a Christian belief, a theist belief. The majority of scientists do agree that the universe had a beginning. The universe had a beginning. So that means that the universe must have had a cause. So let's go through some arguments on that. You guys know Stephen Hawking. Stephen Hawking says that almost everyone now believes that the universe, and even time itself, that it had a beginning. So let's go through these arguments. Whatever begins to exist has a cause. The universe began to exist, therefore the universe has a cause. Well, what could the cause be? There was no pre-existing matter or energy. There was nothing. This is why Anthony Kinney of Oxford University says if someone's an atheist and they don't want to admit that God exists, for example, they must believe that the universe came from nothing and by nothing, but that doesn't make any scientific sense at all. Out of nothing, nothing comes. Whatever begins to exist has a cause. The universe began to exist. Therefore, the universe has a cause. I am positing that the cause must be uncaused because you can't have an infinite regress. It must be changeless, timeless, immaterial, because there was no pre-existing matter or energy, and it must be personal. Now, let's mosey on to the next one. Now, by the way, on that, there's only two possible – let me mosey on back here. There's only two possible candidates that fit that description. Number three there, you see it? The cause must be uncaused, changeless. Think about it. What are some things that have – that did not begin to exist? Well, most folks believe that abstract objects, like numbers, for example, like the number seven, that numbers exist, you know, necessarily. But the number seven can't cause anything. What's another thing that is not caused? Well, that's what everyone believes when we talk about God. It follows that the transcendent cause of the universe is an unembodied mind. It's not material. And thus we're brought not merely to an uncaused cause of the universe, but to its personal creator. Let's mosey on down the line. And I'm timing myself. I'll probably finish early because I'm moving along. The fine-tuning is amazing. Robert Jastrow of Goddard, of NASA's Goddard Institute for Space Studies, he calls the fine-tuning these constants I'm going to go through right now, guys. There's about 50 of them. If you want to see them, go to shotgunnow.net and click links, and you'll see the list. But let me go through some of them now. He calls this the most powerful evidence for the existence of God ever to come out of science. And at the beginning of the universe, these constants had to be exquisitely fine-tuned. There's about 50 life-permitting constants. If you were to adjust one of those constants, like just a hair's breadth, you could actually destroy life. And they've looked at these constants. You could see some of them on the screen. And they've realized that these constants can't be due to dumb luck or chance. And chance doesn't stand in causation of anything. Chance doesn't cause things. So they said, well, maybe it's due to look what religion's talking. And by the way, religion, all your profanity is not even showing up on the video because I'm recording without the other thing, unless that's another troll. So anyways, religion, the guy I'm debating is cussing right now, going nuts. Come on, religion, be nice. Really? It was the guy that we were, okay, the guy that I was debating, hey, Mega, was it the guy I was debating? Mega, would you be so kind, not to put you on the spot, would you get on the mic and explain what just happened here, because I'm recording. Nightmares, I'll just stay focused. Well, if he's gone, I'm not going to keep going unless another atheist wants to pick up the banner. But Mega, would you explain in a couple of words or whatever what just happened here? Because when I record and upload this to YouTube, I don't want people to think that we were unfair. So let me get off the mic if one of the mods don't mind getting on and explaining what happened here.
Good, my voice is going to be on YouTube now. Anyways, yeah, the religion is a joke guy. He wasn't here to debate. He just started spamming a bunch of cuss words and profanities at you, and really had no purpose for being here. I think you guys were even talking about earlier, he said that he has no interest in even debating or something like that, and you asked him, well, then why are you even here, right? So, yeah, so I tend to ban the trolls that do that. You know, if you can't come in here and respect other people and respect the chat room, you know, you're not going to be in here for very long.
Now, Viva, were you here the whole time, Viva, where I asked the guy if he wanted to debate and he said yes? Hey, Viva, would you be so kind to get on the mic? Because, see, I just want you guys to know, and Viva, if you can mention that he did accept the debate challenge. And what I'm saying is it's not like they that we're backing down from their debate challenge. We invite all atheists, agnostics, anyone. It's good to debate. We debate in a friendly manner. So, Viva, would you explain how he said he was going to debate and then what – and just so you know, because he did say that he wanted to debate.
He pretty much just already accepted your challenge and your debate, and then he pretty much said after that, you know what I really get shocked is that they turn around and they accuse us because we're supposed to be like some type of homophobic person, but then he turned around and started calling you the F. Well, he started calling you a fag. And I really just don't get it. It's like, how could somebody turn around and accuse someone of being a bigot, but then turn around and call him a bigot and a fag in the same time? It was kind of silly. Like, this guy really does not really have an eloquent vocabulary in order to come up with something more creative. At least he could channel his anxiety to, or, you know, his frustrations in life. Rather than trolling a room, can he just, you know, go research a video or go read a book, you know, and be well-read at least. And he would be equipped at least to debate you rather than trying to make an idiot out of himself. Well, that's because he was a troll, and that's pretty much what he wanted to do. And he did accept it, though, and I find that rather peculiar. So I just wanted to say that. Here you go, Chuck. Thanks for the mic.
Yeah, so he did accept the debate challenge, and that's what happens. And then Night got a screenshot of him cussing. Now, just are there any other atheists in here that would like to pick up the baton? And I'll go through the slides. And then were there any other atheists here that wanted to debate me? Right now, tumbleweeds are blowing by. There's an old coal miner saying, there ain't no one here, Shock, that wants to debate you. Ding! Okay. Well, then I guess our job's done here. In FUD, you notice, FUD, we use the same arguments each time, so they know. We'll even tell them. I even go first if they want. On to the 15 questions. Okay. Now, XT, do you have a microphone? Oh. Now, XT, can I just say something? You typed in, we are destroyer. You spelled destroyer wrong. It's D-E-S-T-R-O. You kind of spelled it wrong. Why did you spell it XT, we are destroyer? You spelled it wrong. Right. It's interesting, and I agree with what FUD's saying. Okay, well, on to the 15 questions on a debate. Now, if you're an atheist and you feel that you have proof and evidence that, you know, atheism is accurate and correct, we invite you to go to shotgunnow.net and, you know, hop on that unicorn, eat a big bowl of spaghetti monster, high-five the leprechaun, and come on down. You're the next contestant in the debate room. So let's go to the 15 questions and let's be done with this. Okay, we're going to go to the 15 questions really quick, okay? Real quick like. Oh, and I want to give you guys a little update. we have a group put together and we're going to put out 250 hours spending time on the 15 questions for evolutionists. Now, I'm going to go through a list of people we've challenged that have not been able to to answer these 15 questions. We have a guy that bought 2,000 tracks. You know, they got these 15 questions, evolutionists. We have a lot of people that bought the tracks, but there's one guy bought 2,000 of them. He already handed them out, and a lot of people, they'll hand them out at their schools, universities. And then he just bought another 1,000 of them. So throughout the month, we're going to report on how many hours we're logging in. Now, the amazing atheist, and I bring him up because he's the number one most subscribed to atheist on YouTube. Do you know that we challenged him to provide proof and evidence that atheism was accurate and correct, and he honestly admitted that he could not provide proof and evidence that atheism was accurate and correct? Look for the video, Proof Atheism is Madness. You'll see him on there doing it. We challenged Reddit. We challenged the evolutionist at Reddit to come in here and go through these 15 questions for evolutionists with us. They have not done it. They have evolved into chickens. They have not done it. Now, we've challenged Aaron Raw to do it. The Thunderfoot to do it. He hasn't done it either. The Atheist Experience Show hasn't done it. In fact, we challenged Matt Dillahunty and the Atheist Experience Show to provide proof and evidence that atheism was accurate and correct. And Matt Dillahunty said a unicorn in a box. A unicorn in a box proves that atheism is accurate and correct. Folks, atheism is madness. Let's move on. Let's move on fast. Question one. How did life originate? Evolutionist Professor Paul Davies admitted it. Quote, nobody knows how a mixture of lifeless chemicals spontaneously just organized themselves into the first living cell, unquote. Andrew Knoll, professor of biology, Harvard, said, we don't really know how life originated on this planet. A minimal cell needs several hundred proteins. Even if every atom in the universe were an experiment with all the correct amino acids present for every possible molecular vibration in the supposed evolutionary age of the universe, not even one average size functional protein would form. So how did life originate? How did life with hundreds of proteins originate just by chemistry without intelligent design? Look at the website there. Check it out. How did the DNA code originate? You guys know the code is a sophisticated language system with letters and words where the meanings of the words is unrelated to the chemical properties of the letters. Just as the information on this page, or we should say the computer screen, the pixels on the screen, are not related to it. Like, what other coding system has existed without intelligent design? Anybody? How did the DNA system arise without it being created? Francis Crick was the co-discoverer of the double helix DNA, and he was saying that he believes, when he looked at evolution, he says it's almost a miracle. And he even says, you know, it had to be that life was seeded here by something. He believes that maybe meteorites hit the earth and brought life here, you know, and stuff. Question three, how could mutations, which are just accidental copying mistakes, how can mutations create the huge volumes of information in the DNA of living things? Folks, this question here has got Aaron Rock confused, dazed, stumped, and stupefied. Thunderfoot can't answer it. The Reddit evolutionist can't figure it out. The Atheist Experience Show is dazed, confused, and stupefied. They cannot answer it. Look, how could such errors create 3 billion letters of DNA information to change a microbe into a microbiologist? There's information there for how to make proteins and also for controlling their use, much like a cookbook contains the ingredients as well as the instructions for how and when to use them. You guys can read the rest of it, but yeah, exactly, Mega. How could scrambling existing DNA information create a new biochemical pathway? Did you guys ever look at ATP synthase? It's like a 32-component rotary motor. Now, are we really supposed to believe that everything just exploded and now we have the complexity of the cell and the complexity of DNA all due to dumb luck and chance? Folks, I don't have enough blind faith to be an atheist evolutionist. Question four. why is natural selection, which is really a principle recognized by creationists, Viva and I were talking about this recently, that natural selection originally was a creationist idea. The person that originally came up with it was a creationist. But why is natural selection taught as evolution? Look what it says. Natural selection, by definition, is a selective process. It's not a creative process. In other words, it might explain the survival of the fittest, but not the arrival of the fittest. And you guys can read the rest of that later. Question 5. How did new biochemical pathways, which involve multiple enzymes actually working together in sequence, originate? That's a problem for the evolutionist. Every pathway in nanomachine requires multiple protein enzyme components to work. So how did lucky accidents create even one of the components, let alone 10, 20, 30? Look what evolutionary biochemist Franklin Harold wrote, quote, "We must concede that there are presently, look guys, no detailed Darwinian accounts of the evolution of any biochemical or cellular system, only a variety of wishful speculations." Notice, we must concede there are presently no detailed Darwinian accounts of the evolution of any biochemical or cellular system, only a variety of wishful speculations. Reddit evolutionist, where are you? Where are you guys? Why aren't you answering these questions? Thunderfoot, Aaron Raw, The Atheist Experience Show, Richard Dawkins. Of course, Richard Dawkins now is an agnostic. Maybe he's starting to realize that evolution is a fairy tale for adults. Question 6. Living things look like they were designed. Richard Dawkins even admits it. Speak of the devil right here. Richard Dawkins wrote, and I'll use my Richard Dawkins voice, "Biology is the study of complicated things that have the appearance of having been designed with a purpose." Francis Crick, we talked about him earlier. You know, Francis Crick, what he talked about evolution almost being a miracle. A miracle. He just can't see how it could have occurred here, even in a supposed 4.54 billion years. With the complexity of the cell and DNA, even now they're saying 4.54 billion years is not enough time. There was a book out by, Barrow and Tipler, if memory serves me correctly, the Anthropic Cosmological Principle, and they were saying that there's just not enough time for DNA in the cell to actually just evolve. Even 4.54 billion years is not enough time. They said that the sun would have already ceased to be a main sequence star and would have incinerated the Earth. So I believe in our lifetime, guys, we're going to see some radical changes to the way that this is being taught in schools. I think evolution's going extinct. You know what's already gone dead to the wayside? Now what's happened is they've gotten rid of, remember they used to teach a chemical origin of life, that lightning struck the primordial ooze and all of a sudden, you know, we crawled up out of the slime and then the sun was burning on our worm-like head and a complex eye started to grow on our head and we grew up, we crawled up on the water and then lucky us, we met another worm-like creature of the opposite sex and then we mated and then all of a sudden they grew into primates and now we're on MacBooks and IBMs. I mean, come on, you tell that to your kid, they'll laugh at you in your face. I don't believe it either. But you know, they're saying that it's called the Anthropic Cosmological Principle. That was one book we were talking about. There's another book, it'll come to me in a moment. It's called Darwin on Trial. You guys remember the author of that book, Darwin on Trial? He said that basically there's an extrapolation from microevolution, which is change within limits, to macroevolution. And he says the reason why people are positing macroevolution is because they have a presuppositional belief in naturalism. In other words, they're biased. They're not going where the evidence is. they're extrapolating from microevolution and they're positing macro. Look what Richard Dawkins says. Biology is the study of complicated things that have the appearance of having been designed with a purpose. Dawkins admits it right there. Francis Crick says that biologists must constantly keep in mind that what they see was not designed but rather evolved. Can you imagine these biologists in the lab trying to brainwash themselves saying it's not designed, it's not designed? That's sad. Question 7, how did multicellular life originate? How did cells adapted to individual survival learn to cooperate and specialize? I appreciate you guys. Let me go through this. Question 8, how did sex originate? You guys know that asexual reproduction gives up to twice as much reproductive success, you know, fitness, for the same resources as sexual reproduction. So how could the latter ever gain enough advantage to be selected? Question 9, and you guys know this is the major nail in the evolutionist coffin. Where are these millions of transitional fossils that we were promised by Darwin? You know, when Darwin was around, they were in horse and buggies. Darwin didn't even know about the cell, the complexity of the cell. They actually thought it was like a glob of goo. It's true. Do the research. Darwin and Huxley, they actually believed that the cell was really just like a glob of goo. You guys in the room know more about the cell than they did. Now that we know the complexity of the cell, it's the entire world in the cell, extremely complex. There's no possible way it could have evolved. Even 4.54 billion years is not enough. This is why the complexity of the cell and DNA evolution is dying on the vine. Evolution is going extinct. Darwin noted the problem, and it still remains. Why are the expected countless millions of transitional fossils missing? Now, I got to tell you guys something funny. Yeah, exactly, Mega. I got to tell you guys something funny. We were talking to an evolutionist one time, and he actually said that there are transitional fossils, but the creationists are buying them up and hiding them from the public. Really? Really? That's what the evolutionist is saying. I said, well, where are these countless millions of transitional fossils? And he goes, well, the creationists buy them up and then they hide them from the public. And I go, do you have any evidence for that? I mean, this is just ridiculous. No creationists are buying up the fossils, hiding them. They are not there. These fossils are missing. There is a lack of proof and evidence. Darwin noted the problem, and it still remains. You know those evolutionary family trees and textbooks, guys? They're all based on imagination, not fossil evidence. Just because you draw a fake little tree in a textbook doesn't prove that the fossils are there. Where are the fossils? Where are they, guys? You know that they don't have these transitional fossils. They've collected over a billion fossils, but these fossils just show microevolution. They're not showing macroevolution. Stephen Jay Gould, and this guy's not a creationist. He's an evolutionist, right? Look what he said. He admits it. He goes, look, the extreme rarity of transitional forms in the fossil record persists as the trade secret of paleontology. And other evolutionist fossil experts admit the same thing. How do the living fossils, this is a big problem for evolution too, and you can see why rational, intelligent people don't buy into evolution, because we got living fossils, guys, that they say are supposed hundreds of millions of years old, and they haven't changed. Why do they remain unchanged? I thought it was supposed to change. It's not changing. If evolution has changed worms into humans in the same time frame. Almost done. How did blind chemistry create mind, intelligence, meaning, altruism, and morality? If I asked you guys, do you love your mom? Do you love your dad? Do you love anybody? You say, yeah, I love my mom, dad, my sister. I love. You love these people. Where does this come from? You have a mind. You can choose to come into the conference room here. You can choose to go get some food and eat. Your mind just doesn't guide you around. Your brain just doesn't guide you around without your control, you can actually choose what you can do, you know? You have a mind. Well, where does morality come from also? You know, I was in a debate with a guy on, it'll come to me, it was a Christian radio station, I think it was CTI radio, and I was debating, I thought the guy was an atheist, but during the debate, he was an agnostic. He said he was an agnostic. So I asked him, do you believe that rape is wrong? And he said, well, it's subjective, right? This guy was an evolutionist. And I said, well, then give me an instance when rape would be okay. And he said, well, it's never okay. And I said, well, then this is morality. That's objective morality. It's never okay. You can hear him if you guys want that audio of the radio debate that I had. Go to shotgunnow.net and click music podcast, and you'll hear him admit that it's never okay. This is objective morality. Well, we don't get that from evolution. And if everything evolved and we invented God, is what evolutionary teaching says, then what purpose or meaning is there to human life? Let's mosey right along. We're almost done, guys. Why is evolutionary gesso storytelling tolerated? We had a real nice guy in here the other day, and he was saying he believes in evolution. And we asked him, where are the transitional fossils? How many of them do we have? And he said, well, let me think for a moment. And he didn't know the number. He didn't. So they'll just want us to accept evolution based on blind faith. I think you guys have the right to demand proof and evidence. If there's no proof and evidence, then why are you believing it? It is a religion. Evolution is a religion. I'm going to show you some more reasons why. Evolutionists often use flexible storytelling to explain observations contrary to evolutionary theory. Let's mosey right along. Where are the scientific breakthroughs due to evolution? In fact, evolution hinders science. Dr. Mark Kirshner, he's the chair of the Department of Systems Biology, Harvard Medical School. He stated, quote, in fact, over the last 100 years, almost all of biology has proceeded except evolutionary biology itself. Molecular biology, biochemistry, physiology have not taken evolution into account at all. Look what it says. Evolution actually hinders medical discovery. That hurts people. That doesn't help people. If it's hindering medical discovery, what I say is, why don't we get the wooden stake of truth and drive it through the heart of this fictional, dishonest evolutionary theory? It's time. It's dying anyways, guys. Let's just speed up the process. Let's go on to question 14. We're almost done. I appreciate you guys hanging with us here. Science involves experimenting to figure out how things work. Do you know evolution fails the scientific method? How they operate? Why is evolution a theory about history? See, science involves experimenting to figure out how things work, how they operate. So why is a theory about history, which that's what evolution is, taught as if it is the same as operational science? You cannot do experiments. Evolution fails the scientific method. You can't even observe what happened. Look what agnostic Richard Dawkins said. And I say agnostic because you guys know Richard Dawkins said he's not an atheist. He's an agnostic. So Richard Dawkins, the number one most famous agnostic in the world, said, evolution has been observed. It's just that it hasn't been observed while it's happening. That's why you don't want to let a biology someone like Richard Dawkins out of the lab too often. Question 15. Why is a fundamentally religious idea a dogmatic belief system that fails to explain the evidence taught in science classes? You have a right to be angry that your children are being lied to about this crapola. Karl Popper, famous philosopher of science, said, Darwinism is not a testable scientific theory, but a metaphysical religious research program. Michael Ruse, he believes in evolution. Evolution is science philosopher. He admitted evolution is a religion. This was true of evolution in the beginning, and it is true of evolution still today. If you can't teach religion in science classes, why is evolution taught? And by the way, I just remember that name of that guy, Darwin on Trial, Philip Johnson, I believe was the guy's name. Philip Johnson, Darwin on Trial. He said that what these evolutionists are doing is they're extrapolating from microevolution and they're saying macroevolution is true when he said there's no evidence for that. He said their claims are not based on evidence, but a presuppositional belief in naturalism. I appreciate you guys watching the 15 questions, and I'm going to kind of write something on the whiteboard, and then we'll finish it here. If you guys want to come into the conference room, all right, I'll hurry, Mega. Here's what you do. You go to this website here. And I'm writing this with the mouse, so. This is where we're all at. This is where the whole gang is at right now. We're all in the conference room. You go to shotgunnow.net. Okay. Let me get the little pencil thing. So you go to shotgunnow.net. Someone else is drawing stuff. And you can go to www.shotgunnow.net. And when you go there, it'll say, someone's writing, no games. Yes, when you come in, yeah, there's the dunce hat. When you come in, look, we love you, atheist evolutionists. We want you to be saved. We want to have all of us go ahead and believe in truth. Don't buy into this fairy tale of evolution. Look, you got Richard Dawkins even saying that he doesn't know how life originated. He just believes on faith that it all just popped into existence. I mean, come on, guys. And now Richard Dawkins is an agnostic. You know, he said he doesn't like being called an atheist. You got Christopher Hitchens. When Hitchens was alive, they asked him, you know, give us some arguments why we should believe atheism is true, and he didn't have any. All right, guys, thanks for watching. We'll open up the chat, and we'll see you at shotgunnow.net and in the chat room. Go ahead, Mega.
Yeah, so about the whole micro leading to macro thing, I was talking with someone on the God page on Facebook. It's an atheist debate page, but anyways, so this guy, he started out, he was bashing Christians, and he said something like, well, why do Christians deny observable facts, is what he said. And I said, oh, really? What observable facts do we deny? And then he responds to you, do you deny evolution? And I'm like, well, what do you mean by evolution? I don't deny microevolution, but I deny macroevolution. Because, and I say that macroevolution has never been observed. He says, well, micro leads to macro, and I explain the whole thing where I go through the common ancestry and how, you know, if all animals have a common ancestor, then at some point I know micro doesn't lead to macro, Nia. And I explained how, you know, the common ancestry, if dogs and bats had a common ancestor, then at some point in time, this common ancestor was not a dog and was not a bat, so therefore, at some point, two non-dogs had to give birth to a dog, and two non-bats had to give birth to a bat. But such a thing has never been observed. And he said, yes, macroevolution has never been observed. And then I say, okay, so you say that Christians deny observable facts, but then you admit that macroevolution is not an observable fact. Therefore, we're not denying observable facts. We're denying things that have not been observed. That kind of caught him on that one. He got kind of mad after that.
Exactly, Mega. And that's the thing is, look, we got Nia here in the room, and I said, look, how many fossils do we have that show macroevolution? And he said, well, quite a bit. And I said, how many? And they just don't have any. You see, that's what we're talking about when we talk about evolutionary just-so storytelling. You know, you can't say, oh yeah, we got quite a bit of fossils. Well, you don't have any fossils showing macroevolution, Nia. We don't even have one. Nia, just give me an approximate number, my friend. Just type in a number. Approximately how many fossils do we have? Nia, a number. Nia, we're recording this. Just give us a number, Nia, approximately. 5? Did you type in 1? Now he says he doesn't know. Well, thank you, Nia, for being honest. You see, guys, we made progress here. Nash, you can... Yeah, you know, Nash, that's one of the things, too, is sometimes they'll say, well, every fossil is a transitional fossil. Then... Right, Mega's right, 0. And that's the problem is every fossil can't be a transitional fossil. They just don't get it. And that's why when you really think about it, we've found over like a billion fossils. It's just not there, you know. There's a problem. All right, Nia. Okay, Nia, you know the difference between micro and macro evolution, right? Okay, so here's the question that I wanted you to think of is, you ever see that, you know, Darwinian tree of life thing? Okay, now Nia's using his profanity. No, that's fine, Nia. All right, guys, thanks for we'll do open mic. Did any of you guys want to go on the recording before we end the recording? Viva, did you want to say anything? Viva Ramonas. All right. Yeah, Viva. So Viva's going to get on. He knows a lot about this also. And what say you, Lee, Via? Yes, Fudd, we have Fudd's going Christian on me here. That's good. But I don't drive a Mercedes AMG. I got like a little cheap Mercedes, like probably it's only worth $2,000. And I tell people about Arma, the game Arma. I don't get anything if you guys download the free demo of Arma. But I like that game Arma. I'm looking forward to Arma 3, which comes out at the year 2000. All right. I see Nia's. Okay, Nia, you can't be that bad because you're an Arma player. All right, ladies and gentlemen, the world famous Viva Ramona.
Thanks, Shock. That just puts a little bit of scare tactics on me, you know. Thank you for saying I'm popular. I wanted to talk about Shock. This would be something you would want to say. Okay, there's this something called a reunification fallacy, okay? And what happens when they start to say a reunification, what it means is, is that when they're trying to use a fallacy of ambiguity and they... or an abstract belief or a hypothetical construct, and they treat it as if it's real or if anything. So what they're trying to do is, and also they're trying to create a no true Scotman fallacy as well. And they're trying to say, oh, well, you know, everything is a transitional fossil. Well, then that just brings an ambiguity to a concept that is not even real in the first place. So they're trying to move the goalpost, and it's ambiguous. It's basically creating the fallacy of reunification, trying You're transitioning into a zebra. Yeah, exactly. But wait, why is there stasis in the fossil? And I remember, yeah, exactly. And the story is just because, exactly, it goes down to I told you so. It's just so. Just don't question it. Don't say anything. It's because, at least in the biblical record, you can actually see historical records and pull them up. So it's not exactly, you're not getting an appeal to authority. You're getting from people that are like, hey, yeah, there's these Christians. Oh, yeah, this. Oh, yeah, And then there's documentations that prove the Bible to be accurate and correct. So it's like, well, and then there's historical method, there's archaeological evidence, there is all this stuff, and it compiles into each other. And but the problem is you don't see any of the fossils like that. It's just because it's because they said so. There is so many holes in that. Did you know what I just realized, Shock? Shock, I want you to think about this. It's something really surprising that they don't tell you. That did you know that dinosaurs are found with modern animals? Okay, first of all, it's also found with flamingos. Now let's think about that. Flamingos. Now what? Why is there flamingos with? So you're telling me birds are with dinosaurs? I thought birds were actually after the dinosaurs. So how does that happen? So the geological column, it's not only that it's messed up. So they think the T-Rex turned into a chicken. That's, I'm like, I can't believe that. I'm sorry, I just can't. That's what they actually believe. And you see birds that are buried with it. So it's kind of silly. Most fossils are found because of erosion has exposed. No, I'm saying that they're buried in the same layer of strata. That's what I'm saying, bud. So you guys are saying like, oh, but if you find something in the wrong position, and you know that I'm a mod, right, Nia? Just letting you know, I could shut up whenever I like. So, a matter of fact, I can throw you out. So, maybe you should be. Flamingos have resistance to meteors. Using Pokemon terminology. Do you use your Pokédex? Hey, you know what, Shock? This is what they're going to say. This is one day. This is what they're going to tell you. The proof of evolution is in Pokemon because Pokemon told me. Because Pokemon, so Charizard, they're like, so it's true, guys. See, there you go. My little Pokédex told me too. Because if it's in a show, it's definitely true. That's for sure. And matter of fact, yes, you do see. There's also a lot of the falls in the Precambrian they found. They actually found pollen contamination in there. So it's like, how do you find pollen and that sort of thing? I'm not. I could see you banning trolls. No, I'm not saying that, Fud. You don't realize what it is. The guy's telling me, shh, shh, shh. And I'm just like, hey, you know that I am a moderator. You know that, right? Or small. Yeah, exactly. He's telling me, shh. And I'm like, that's not. I don't have to shut up or anything. So, guys, yes. Remember, guys. Pokemon told there's evolution. So it's true, guys. Because Pokemon told me, I will believe it. And it's like, burying a computer, like an old 286 shock, and then trying to find an iPod afterwards. Or trying to find an iPod Touch. It's like, hey, there you go. Suck at Pokemon. No, you don't. Megan, no, you don't. So anyway, here you go. Shock, if you want to talk.
All right. Hey, thanks, Viva. Did any evolutionist want to get on the mic and talk about how many transitional fossils we have? My sweet lord, did you have a question? Because it says you have a question. Well, you know, my sweet lord, let's talk about that. For example, have you guys heard that they say the Catholic Church accepts evolution? But if you actually look at what the Catholic Church is saying, they're not saying the Catholic Church is not saying that they believe that everything came about by purely naturalistic means. If you read, and I'm not a Catholic, but if you read their statement, they believe that God was involved with the creation of man. So that's not really evolution, that's creation. Like, for example, my sweet lord, who's asking the question, you might believe that God used, like, well, let me read it to you, okay? Let me read you something from Scripture. Let me get it. Hold on. I got to get the Old Testament, which is over here. Okay, check this out. Okay, watch. So check this out, my sweet lord. In the first page of Genesis, it says, then God said, and I'll tell you what passage I'm reading from, Genesis 1:11, right? Then God said, let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seed and fruits bearing fruit after their kind, with seed in them on the earth. And it was so. So, my sweet lord, do you notice that God is saying, let the earth do it? You notice that? So God is saying, let the earth sprout vegetation. So these people that are saying they're theistic evolutionists, if I ask them, do you agree with that passage? They're going to say, of course I agree with that. Well, that's creation. If you ask an atheist, do you agree with that passage? What part are they going to disagree with? They don't like the part where it says, then God said. So the atheist has no problem with part of that passage. The atheist loves that the earth does it. They just don't want God involved with it. So really, if you talk to an evolutionist that's an atheist, they believe that, right, thanks, Mega. So you can't say that you believe like in this Darwinian evolution where everything came about without God, right? Oh, yeah, Fudd, I agree with you there, too. Fudd says, I think the part that evolutionists have a problem with is the limit between macro and micro. Right, exactly. They seem to have a problem with that, but then there's evolutionists that say, you know, we're missing these fossils that show transition. So I think the problem is they were teaching that macroevolution was true without the evidence first. They had the evidence for micro, which is change within limits, as you guys know, but there's macroevolution still hasn't been proven. So they're extrapolating macro from micro. And by the way, my sweet lord, check this out. Here's another passage. Genesis 1:20. Then God said, listen, guys, let the waters teem with swarms of living creatures. You notice that? So the living creatures, it begins within the waters. Now, listen to this, my sweet lord. It says, then God said, and this is Genesis 1:24, let the earth bring forth living creatures after their kind, cattle and creeping things and beasts of the earth after their kind. So you notice it's saying, let the earth do it. Let this do it. So, my sweet lord, the atheist evolutionists have absolutely no problem with what I just read, if you take God out of the picture. So let me give you an example, and I don't want to say the guy's name because, you know, but there was a guy on YouTube that he was mocking creationists.
And so I talked to the guy, you know, through email back and forth on YouTube, and he goes, oh, well, I'm a Christian. And I go, well, why would you mock creationists, right? And he's kind of a younger person, so I think he just wanted, you know, the praise of his atheist evolutionist friends, right? I really believe that. Because it's unchristian to actually mock Christians, right? One of the things that God hates, if you look up, it's the seven things that God hates, it'll say someone that causes division among the brethren. God hates that. So I'm like, why would this guy be mocking Christians, right? And calling them, you know, names for believing God created man, right? So I emailed the guy and I asked him, I said, look, I'm kind of confused here. You say you're a Christian, but you're mocking other Christians because they believe God created man and woman. So I asked him, I said, look, point blank, I said, do you believe God was in any way involved in the creation of man and woman? And he wrote back like five paragraphs, and I had to find, you know, the part where he was answering my question because he was talking about all the stuff that I didn't even ask about. And I found it, and he said, yes, I already told Once Forgiven, Now Free, which I guess is another guy on YouTube that's a Christian, that he asked the same thing. Well, why are you mocking creationism? He goes, I already told Once Forgiven, Now Free that I do believe God is the creator of all things. Well, that's not Darwinian evolution. That's creation. So I think these people that are calling themselves theistic evolutionists, they're really just creationists. They really are. Because when I talk to them, I go, do you believe that God... Oh, yeah, I believe all those passages that you read to me, you know. They believe in those passages. That God... They believe in what I just read you from Genesis. But, like, let me give you another example. Have you guys heard of Dr. William Lane Craig? The atheist will dishonestly say that he's an evolutionist. And they'll say, oh, Craig believes in evolution. But that's not really true. Craig's like us. He says macroevolution is not proven, but micro is. Just like what Mega was saying and what all of us agree with here. Macroevolution is not proven. The jury's still out on that. They haven't found these transitional fossils. So you got to be very careful, you know, people will be dishonest and they'll say so-and-so believes in evolution, but when you actually look at what they believe, they really don't. Anyone that knows Dr. William Lane Craig also and his beliefs, he clearly believes God exists. He's a Christian. And he has no problem with macroevolution. He believes in that. I do too. Everyone in this room does, because that's just change within limits, you know. But he says that macroevolution is not proven, and I think he's right. But then I've talked to atheists, and they'll say, oh, he's an evolutionist. I go, no, he's not. He's a creationist. He believes in God. So microevolution is just, you know how Scripture says that God created them after their own kinds? That's just creation. But they name it the phrase microevolution, you know. Yeah. Are you familiar with them? Nia, they're referring to William Lane Craig, the gentleman I'm talking about. All right, guys. Well, thanks for participating. What did we learn today? Okay, look, we learned that microevolution, no problem with that. That's just God's creation, change within limits. But macroevolution, there is no proof and evidence that macroevolution is true. My friend Nia here even said he doesn't know. Nia, you should do some research and look at – yeah, I appreciate your honesty, my friend. You should look at that. There's nothing wrong. I mean, you could – if someone wants to, you know, go ahead and be a atheist or an evolutionist or an agnostic or whatever – you know, we can't stop them from doing that. We think it's a big mistake. But why would someone say that macroevolution is true when there's no evidence? I don't get that. Now, as a Christian, listen, as a Christian, I have no problem if it was true. Big deal. It doesn't affect my Christian walk with God in any way at all.
But it, my the reason why Christians don't believe in macroevolution has nothing to do with their Christian beliefs. It has to do with the lack of proof and evidence. There's no scientific evidence that it's true.